Thank you, Mr. Chair. First, I would like to express my sincere thanks and appreciation to Professor Possillon and her colleagues for the organization of this event. I'm very pleased to have this opportunity to address an important issue, which is the mapping issue in relation to unilateral sanctions. I have to disclose at the outset that I've been working on that topic for several years in my capacity as a legal advisor to the United Nations Special Rapporteur on the precise title is the Special Rapporteur on the Adverse Impact of Unilateral Coercive Measures on the Enjoyment of Human Rights, which is in itself a title that reflects the concerns that have led the UN to establish that mandate. It is a mandate, the Special Rapporteur is one of the special procedures within the Human Rights Council. It has been established by the Human Rights Council in coordination with the UN General Assembly. The task of the Special Rapporteur is to monitor the adverse impact that unilateral sanctions may have on various human rights, and to seek to identify ways and means for victims of those adverse impacts on human rights to obtain remedies and redress in one way or another. That said, I will speak in my personal capacity, and any reference that I will make to statements and reports of the Special Rapporteur is publicly available in the reports that the Special Rapporteur has submitted every year to the Human Rights Council and to the General Assembly. The mandate of the Special Rapporteur is focused on the issue of human rights, so it does not focus on the public international law aspects of unilateral sanctions. But in the course of the mandate, it has proven necessary to get into the legalities of these issues. So that I will refer to some of these questions. United Nations organs have time and again, as you may know, adopted resolutions that reflect the principled opposition of the vast majority of the international community to the use of unilateral sanctions, which are quite often referred to in UN documents, UN resolutions, as unilateral coercive measures. So I will refer to these as UCMs from now. One of the most recent instances of such condemnation is Resolution 72/201 of 2018 of the General Assembly, where the Assembly, using a now well-established language, I quote, urges the international community to adopt urgent and effective measures to eliminate the use of unilateral coercive economic measures against developing countries that are not authorized by relevant organs of the UN or are inconsistent with the principles of international law as set forth in the Charter and that contravene the basic principles of the multilateral trading system. End quote. You find a similar condemnation in the latest resolution adopted in December 2018 by the General Assembly under the heading Human Rights and Unilateral Coercive Measures, where states are called to cease, I quote, adopting or implementing any unilateral measures not in accordance with international law, international humanitarian law, the Charter, and the norms and principles governing peaceful relations between states, which of course raises the issue of whether some of these measures can be in compliance with international law at all, which is a deep divide in the international community between those countries that state that Any UCMs are unlawful per se, and those countries which maintain that in some cases UCMs can be lawful. The term UCM is of quite recent use. Such measures are also referred to as unilateral economic measures or coercive economic measures. The origins of the concept of UCMs can be traced back to the early years of the United Nations. For instance, in 1950, the International Law Commission of the UN, during its work on the draft code of offenses against the peace and security of mankind, addressed the issue of whether it should be considered as an international crime. I quote: "The fact of a state applying measures of psychological or economic coercion in respect of another state." Also, in the context of the work at the ILC on international crimes of states, the concept of economic aggression or economic threat was considered as a possible discrete form of aggression under international law. Then during the 60s and the preparatory work of what was to become the Vienna Convention on the Law of Treaty, on the Law of Treaties, there was a discussion on, there was an amendment that was considered, the purpose of which was to add economic or political pressure as a case of nullity of treaties concluded under threat of use of economic or political pressure. Then, in a spirit of compromise, that amendment was withdrawn. Following the consent of the conference, the preparatory conference on the law of treaties, to include as an annex to the final act a detailed declaration on the prohibition of military, political, or economic coercion in the conclusion of treaties. To date, the term unilateral coercive measures does not seem to have a fully agreed upon definition, although the contours of the concept are quite uncontroversial. But for instance, I believe that the EU makes a distinction between unilateral coercive measures that it rejects and its own restrictive measures. So it's a bit controversial. UCMs, prima facie, cover the use of economic measures taken by one state to compel a change in policy of another state. However, the view has been expressed that the term unilateral may be used in a broader sense to include states, groups of states, and autonomous international organizations, regional organizations, unless such measures are authorized under Chapter 7 of the Charter. And this is the understanding of the concept that has been retained by the mandate of the Special Rapporteur, who has stated in a number of occasions that he would consider as unilateral, I quote, consider as unilateral coercive measures any measures other than those taken by the Security Council under Article 41 of the Charter. So at the level of the mandate of the Special Rapporteur, there is no such thing as collective restrictive measures. So that's a point. On the basis of what I just mentioned, the following working definition of the term UCMs has been put forward by an advisory committee of the Human Rights Council. I quote: UCMs are can be understood as the use of economic, trade, or other measures taken by a state, groups of states, or international organizations acting autonomously to compel a change in policy of another state or to pressure individuals, groups, and/or entities believed to be in a position in targeted states. to influence the course of action without the authorization of the Security Council. End quote. That being said, UCMs arguably cover not only comprehensive measures, such as comprehensive trade embargoes and similar measures, but also targeted or so-called smart sanctions, which are used by states and international organizations against individuals or entities believed to be in a position of power to influence or determine actions in targeted states. On the other hand, the special rapporteur has expressed the view that coercive measures that are imposed by regional organizations on their own members or on candidates to membership are not usually considered as unilateral, to the extent that they are part of a package of rights and obligations whose prior acceptance by the target country are conditions for membership, so that we do not look at this kind of measures. However, the use by international financial institutions by one of several member states of these institutions through their weighted voting rights in these organizations as means to impose UCMs, for instance, in opposing the granting of loans or financing in targeted countries by World Bank entities, has been considered as falling within the mandate of the UN Special Rapporteur. You may see that there's an issue of identification of what falls under the definition of UCMs. What makes the identification of cases of recourse to UCMs quite difficult in practice and often controversial is the fact that, for obvious reasons, states or regional organizations may have, and in practice often do have, an interest in labeling or characterizing the relevant measures, not as UCMs, but otherwise. Quite often, UCMs are used as, or are labeled as, countermeasures in the meaning of the ILC's draft articles on state responsibility. On that, what can be said is that it may, of course, be considered as desirable from an international law perspective that UCMs are be used only in cases where they meet the criteria, they fit within the legal regime of countermeasures, so that their intrinsic unlawfulness may be precluded to the extent that these constitute a legitimate in the meaning of the draft articles. But from the viewpoint of the mandate, irrespective of whether certain given measures may qualify as countermeasures, these measures would still arguably qualify as UCMs if they fall under the definition that I previously quoted. In other words, the fact that a given measure arguably qualifies as a non-precluded countermeasure does not necessarily entail that it does not constitute a UCM, especially from human rights perspective, where the issue of legality is assessed independently or irrespective of the issue of the human rights impact of the measure. On a related note, there may be measures that prima facie meets the criteria of retorsion in the meaning of international law. So retorsion understood as a measure taken by a state which is unfriendly vis-à-vis another state, but which at the same time is not inconsistent with any international obligation of the state engaging in it, even though it may be a response to an internationally wrongful act of the target state. Acts of retorsion, whatever the motivation, could still qualify as UCMs is if they fall under the definition. In brief, in order to identify a UCM in any given situation, what matters is not the title of the measure in the legal instrument, legislative, domestic, or international. So the legal instrument which purports to enact the measure. What matters is not the object or purpose of the measure. What matters is not its international or domestic legal basis, if any, or its stated legal or moral justification. What matters is whether the measure considered meets the criteria of UCMs as broadly set out in the UN resolutions that I quoted. And this implies that a range of different measures used in practice by states and regional organizations can qualify as UCMs, while at the same time they do not necessarily amount to full blockades or comprehensive embargoes or even targeted sanctions in the rather classical form of asset freezes or travel bans, but unconventional measures can also qualify as UCMs. For instance, I can quote just a few examples. Cutting transportation links. There was an instance in 2015 where it was alleged that India had obstructed to the transit point between it and Nepal, causing severe economic harm to Nepal. And this was viewed by some analysts as an undeclared blockade of Nepal. So that's an instance of the cutting of transportation links. Also, the interruption of the flow of or delivery of energy or commodities. There were several reported instances of the cutting of gas flows in Central Asia in recent years, especially during the winter period. Also, the suspension on conditionality of humanitarian aid. Also, the denying of regulatory approvals or licenses, the withholding of pre-agreed loans, etc. All this points to the need for mapping UCMs in order to assess the importance of the phenomenon. The need for mapping unilateral sanctions flows from several considerations. The UN General Assembly regularly requests the UN Special Rapport Secretary General, the UN Secretary General to monitor the imposition of UCMs and to study the impact of such measures on the affected countries, especially the impact on trade and development. Of course, being in a position to determine what qualifies as a UCM and to determine if and when UCMs are being used and to collect comprehensive data on the effective use of UCMs is a prerequisite for such monitoring and impact assessment, especially as far as human rights are concerned. The Special Rapporteur on UCMs has stated that, I quote, the first obstacle to a global evaluation of the negative impact of unilateral sanctions on human rights is the unavailability of global and standardized updated data, and that full transparency in this regard would be helpful to the UN, to private enterprises involved in international trade, and to the civil society at large. The Special Rapporteur also stressed that it would even be the availability of such standardized and comprehensive data on UCMs would even be of use to the Security Council in order for the Security Council to be in a position to better evaluate whether its own measures under Chapter 7 would be warranted or should be changed in one way or another in any given case. As it exists today, the information gathering at the UN level on the practice of UCMs is not satisfactory. How does it work? It works through requests of the UN General Assembly to the Secretary General to collect the views of states and information on the implications and negative effects of UCMs on their populations, and to submit reports on this. Pursuant to those requests, the Office of the High Commissioner on Human Rights regularly sends requests to diplomatic missions in Geneva in order to collect their views. Unfortunately, there are usually very few replies to such requests, very few replies submitted by governments. There are various UN member states that identify themselves in statements to the UN as, I quote, countries affected by unilateral measures. Just to give you an example, the latest report of the UN Secretary General on the item unilateral coercive measures as a means of political and economic coercion against developing countries quotes the following countries as having reported negative impacts of such measures on their countries: Burundi, Cuba, Jordan, the Russian Federation, the Sudan, and the Syrian Arab Republic. Independently from annual reports of the Secretary General, there are other states that at various times in recent years have identified themselves as affected by UCMs, for instance, Belarus, which was until quite recently, I believe, subject to US and EU restrictive measures, and also Qatar, which has been subjected for some years now to unilateral measures enacted by its GCC neighboring states. And you know that item, Qatar is currently challenging the legality of those measures in various fora, especially before the International Court of Justice, where it claims that some restrictive measures enacted against it amount to violations of the International Convention on the Elimination of Racial Discrimination on the Basis of Nationality. So that's an interesting case to follow. That being said, that there are few instances where countries positively state that they do not use UCMs as a matter of principle or of policy, and that they are not themselves subjected to UCMs. But it's very unusual. I found two instances. There may be other instances, but I found the case of Andorra, which in 2012 stated to the UN that, I quote, it does not adopt or implement and consequently does not recognize or encourage the use of economic, political, or any other type of unilateral measures that are not in accordance with international law. Furthermore, it strongly condemns any such measure, and it states, finally, that its population is currently not coerced nor subordinated in the exercise of its sovereign rights by any other state. So that's an instance of a positive declaration. Also, I found a similar statement by Trinidad and Tobago, stating in 2012 that, I quote, there are to date no recorded incidents of the application of UCMs by the government of Trinidad and Tobago. But these instances of voluntary disclosure are and remain very isolated case for quite understandable reasons. This points to the need of some form of some tool to for the mapping of unilateral measures. I will just briefly describe what has been suggested by the mandate of the UN Special Rapporteur on that. The Special Rapporteur has advocated the establishment of a consolidated central register at the level of either the UN Security Council or the UN Secretariat to recapitulate the list of all unilateral coercive measures in force. This register would be updated regularly. It would be kept according to the standards currently applied for Security Council sanctions, and it would be made public. What has been suggested by the Special Rapporteur is that sender or source states, I mean states using UCMs, would be invited to notify the UN of unilateral coercive measures in force at their initiative and of their evolution, and it could also be open to targeted states. So the precise modalities of such mechanism does still have to be clarified and agreed. What has been observed is that such mechanism could draw on the model of the UN the UN Register of Conventional Arms. You may know that since the 90s, I believe, the early 90s, a UN Register of Conventional Arms has been established, which includes data on international arms transfers and information provided by member states on military holdings, procurement through national production, and relevant policies. That Register of Conventional Arms functions as a universal and non-discriminatory register maintained by the Secretary General at the UN headquarters. Member states of the UN are required to provide the Secretary General with annual reports on import and export of arms. Given the fact that the use of UCMs causes significant human rights concerns, which to some extent are similar to the concerns raised by the proliferation of conventional weapons, the Special Rapporteur has expressed the view that it could be a realistic tool for mapping unilateral sanctions. But otherwise it's very difficult to adopt policies to restrict their use. Just a few words to mention that there may be, information on UCMs may be obtained through national lists or European lists. The EU maintains a comprehensive and regularly updated list of its own restrictive measures, but this is not the case for obvious reasons of undeclared cuttings of transportation links or other kinds of measures. Although there are private service providers that on a commercial basis lists of targeted entities, I think that Thomson Reuters, for instance, provides such services, but these have been found to be, it's difficult to evaluate whether these are quite reliable or updated. So the issue of mapping of unilateral measures remains really outstanding to date. I thank you for your attention.